Hello, my name's Jeremy Malcolm. I'm the Executive Director of Prostasia Foundation, and we're very excited to be bringing the film Butterfly Kisses to you this week in Oakland, California. And right now we have with us on the line three members of the crew of this film. We have the director, Raphael Kapelinski, we have the producer, Merlin Merton, and we have the writer, Greer Ellison. So thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us today.
Well, thank you as well.
Yeah, no worries. Thanks. Thanks for screening the film. I'm excited for everybody to see it.
Yeah, well, it's actually an amazing film that I only by chance really discovered when one of the experts that we work with mentioned that there was a film about, the topic of that we work on, which is child sexual abuse and how to prevent it. One of the risks of making a film like this is that you'll be accused of portraying the protagonist too sympathetically. Did you have any feedback that suggested that the audience wanted Jake to be demonized more for his attractions?
Well, from my perspective as the writer of the film, it was always an extremely difficult balance, and it was always about trying to create an empathy for the character rather than necessarily a sympathy with him. It was about trying to create an understanding of who this boy is as a human being and who this boy is as the kind of the monster that society deems him to be. And what tended to be the case was that the moment that and I'm talking about at script stage, the moment that you began to force any kind of sympathy towards the character, the more people pushed away from it. And so what we really tried to do was create a fair 50-50 representation of this boy as a real boy with a real problem, and then try our best to leave it up to the audience to make up their minds about how they felt about him, rather than trying to force the audience to feel a certain way, because as soon as we did that, it tended to backfire.
To be honest, we developed the project for quite a while with, all the sort of various funding boards. And I think one of the crucial things that Raph certainly was very, very keen on doing was to not demonize the person, but also not necessarily to show him as this great person. We just wanted to portray a human being, and it just so happens that he has this sense of being very attracted to this girl who's like 9 or 10. So I think that's more the angle we went from. We were trying to veer away as far as possible from being a sort of socio-political sort of statement.
So my interpretation of the film was that Jake's story could have turned out differently, and that perhaps the film portrays a turning point in his life that could have gone in a different way. Do you think, and maybe this isn't a question that you can answer, but do you think that our society can reach a point where it can intervene sooner to help people who are struggling with inappropriate thoughts, or is there just too much taboo?
I think that it has to, in some ways. I mean, especially in the UK, currently the system that's in place is that you can't talk about these issues. And if you happen to be a person who feels like this as a young boy, as a teenager, when these thoughts kind of manifest, if you can't talk to anyone about it, all you've got in place then is a system of punishment and no prevention. And to me, the more research I did into it, the more I realized that that's actually too late. If we're waiting until this person has got to a point in their life when they actually do offend, and then we catch them, that's not a time for celebration. No. To me, that's actually gone too far, and I would love it to get to a point where you can actually have a discourse about this, and stop that abuse happening in the first place.
Well, I can't really say anything about the society at large and how it's going to, view people with similar problems. I think it's almost impossible, really, to come up with, some sort of forecast here. I think, the attitude, at least in Europe, towards pedophilia is quite an aggressive one, especially in the United Kingdom, where, as two or three years ago, we had a series of articles in the popular press about different pedophile rings and different celebrities, you know, basically being identified as, you know, pedophiles. So talking about the society as such is really, really tough. Of course, while making the film, we were very careful not to make one fundamental mistake, which was to try to explain to the audience why one becomes a pedophile. And while we were developing the script, a lot of our tutors, mentors, they were trying to suggest that we should go in that direction. And we tried, to be fair, to write a couple of drafts where we had scenes between Jake and doctors and Jake and his parents, and there were long dialogues about, you know, I mean, to try to explain why one might become a pedophile. But very quickly we realized that it was actually the least promising way of attacking the issue.
Yeah.
To me, Butterfly Kisses is about a lot of different things, and pedophilia is only one of them. It's first and foremost a film about loneliness. And mm-hmm. In Jake's case, it is pedophilia that, you know, singles him out. It's pedophilia that makes him lonely. And that's how we tried to approach the issue. We didn't want to make any pronouncements. We didn't want to offer any reasons. We did not try to educate people, simply because we didn't feel like we had a particular insight into pedophilia in the first place. We don't believe that anybody does, to be honest. It's very difficult to talk about how, you know, the society is going to view pedophilia or what the society should do about it. I think it's fair to say that, you know, the overall attitude right now is still very aggressive, you know, very negative. And I think a more humanistic approach to it is still something that is not very common.
Did you speak with, I guess, any experts in terms of the psychology of offenders and people like that who could throw some light into how realistic the portrayal was?
Yes. that was actually a very interesting meeting. We spoke to a doctor who specialised in people who claim to have had the same sort of paedophilic tendency or feelings, but had never acted on them. So this psychiatrist's job was effectively to try and like nurture them out of that and sort of to accept themselves a bit more. But what she did do is she set us up for a lunch, which was me, Raphael, Greer, the writer, and three of these people who were sort of self-professed. We were very, very keen to sort of make it as authentic as possible. And I think if there's one thing that we learned from that whole experience was a lot of these people, some of them, you know, one of them in particular was actually quite popular at school until he was about 12-13, and he realized that he had this feeling which he couldn't get rid of. And really over time what happened was that he just slowly sort of parted ways with all his friends, and he became very, very lonely. And I think the sense of loneliness is something that is quite pervasive across those sort of like sort of, you know, sensibilities and sort of feelings for those sort of people. But yeah, I mean, Butterfly Kisses, the name actually is inspired by one of the characters who has remained anonymous, who actually gave us a lot of like sort of a lot of research material, and we based that or use that in order to try and create as authentic a story as possible. And his name, or the person's name, was Butterfly Kisses.
We started off by exchanging emails with these guys, and they were sending self-destructing emails. So you had about 30 minutes to read the email, and you couldn't take a screenshot and you couldn't print them because they were so scared of being kind of outed. And just to kind of reiterate, these aren't people who have actually done anything wrong. These are just people who have these feelings and are trying to deal with it the best way that they can. So we built up trust over time with these guys, and actually we ended up meeting all three of them for a very strange lunch in London with Merlin and with Raphael. And the more we kind of spoke to them, the more kind of misconceptions that we all had about this kind of person were broken. And the more we realized that actually, you know, these are real people. And these are human beings, and in our minds they shouldn't be kind of outlawed and punished for thoughts that they may have, especially if they're trying their hardest to combat that, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Well, as you just said, there's a lot else in this film. There are a lot of other stories in this film aside from Jake's. Were you conscious of the danger that perhaps the drama and tragedy of Jake's story could overshadow the other incidents and characters in the film? And if so, how did you try and strike the balance that we now see on screen, where there's actually a lot more going on than just his story?
I think, you know, if you look at the structure of the film, a couple of things about it. First of all, it's a very subjective film, meaning that Jake is pretty much in all scenes. His eyes are the camera. In many of the scenes, we view the world through Jake's eyes. So that kind of subjective approach was always something that, you know, we wanted to have as the foundation of the film in terms of aesthetics. Another thing that is very important about it is that although we do have three boys at the center of the film, it was always very clear that the film was really about Jake. And about how Jake's problems impacted his relationship with the other two boys. But again, it was always about Jake. One device in the film that we've employed quite successfully, I think, is having a narrator. One of Jake's friends narrates his story. He tells us who Jake was and what happened to Jake in the end. And it's a literary device. It's something that we see in novels such as, you know, The Great Gatsby, for example, by F. Scott Fitzgerald. But, you know, yet again, that device didn't take away anything from the subjective point of view of the film. So yet again, it's Jake's friend telling us about what happened to Jake, but the film is about what happens to Jake rather than, you know, the three boys in separation from him.
Yeah, well, I think the main kind of turning point in the film, in the writing of the film, actually came quite late on. And what made the film work, one of the major breakthroughs with it, was actually framing the film from Kyle, his best friend's point of view. Because at the end of the film, it's his friends who we're kind of left with.
Yes.
And everything that has been a joke up until that point suddenly becomes a crashing down reality. And although Jake then disappears, you know, we're left with his friends and we're left with kind of the aftermath of his actions. And I think it was very important to show that. And I think the last line of the voiceover in the film, whenever he says, you know, I don't know whether I'd kill him or hug him kind of thing, you know, and that to me sort of sums up the whole idea behind it of is he a human or is he a monster? And, yeah. And I would hope the intention would be that, you know, you're A, conflicted yourself, but B, do you still see him as a boy rather than a monster?
And so do you have any plans for the film after this? I think it deserves a wider audience, and we're trying to, introduce it to a few other people in the San Francisco Bay Area, but do you have any plans beyond that?
I mean, we're just renegotiating our deal with Flix at the moment. And I think what we always wanted to do was actually, this is why this is such an interesting point, you know, with you guys approaching us, because we always felt that what was interesting about the film based on, you know, the premiere at Berlin, for example, because at Berlin they do, I think we had 4 screenings, and most of the 3 of them were, you know, tailored more towards like industry people and, you know, like sales agents, distributors and, you know, reporters and that sort of thing. But the first one did have a portion of the audience which was tailored towards children. And, you know, like sort of teenage, you know, teenage schools and stuff like that, right? So it was very interesting because they loved the film. I mean, they were just like laughing the whole way through. And I think it's because they gauged and really connected with the style of chat that the 3 boys have. You know, it feels very, very authentic. I think the setup of the whole film is actually, it feels very, very real and authentic to that sort of demographic. So it was actually an early discussion we had, but at the time we just gave it to Flix to like go with a more, let's say, like a typical kind of like distribution kind of mechanism. But I think what we'd love to do is at some point, you know, if you know, once we have a bit more sort of stuff together, is we'd love to tour the film around schools and around your sort of institutions and stuff, because I think there is an audience out there who would really, really like sort of love to see this film. And I think everyone who's come out of that film, I remember even when we were doing test screenings before the actual premiere, you know, people came out thinking, wow, this is different, you know? And I think even the themes and like, you know, it's a source of conversation. And as Raph said earlier, you know, we made it a very good point because it was just after a lot, you know, 2 or 3 celebrities in the UK, you know, came into like the sort of foreground in terms of, you know, paedophilia and, you know, like sort of a lot of like sort of sexual allegations against them. But what was interesting, and this is something from the writer, is, you know, the inspiration for the story was partly, you know, imagine these big celebrities, you know, once upon a time, they would have been 16, 17 as well. Yeah. And they may have been going through this whole process. And it's not that they have necessarily some big like issue leading up to it. I mean, that does happen as well. But the victim becoming the victimizer is definitely a story we wanted to stay clear of. You know, our story is more about a normal kid who's got his friends around him. You know, for all intents and purposes, you could call it a normal setup. but he just so happens to have this feeling. And he can't tell anyone, including his 2 best friends.
Yeah, I mean, I think the unique point of this film for me and what interested me in it was always to kind of to break the stereotype of the older man.
Yes.
And to break this idea of, you know, the old creepy man in the trench coat standing at the playground gates, and to say, you know, did this person wake up on his 40th birthday and decide this is what I'm going to do today out of the blue? Probably not. Is this something that this person discovered when they were much younger and has pushed back and fought against most of their life, and then at some point kind of cracked? That's the more likely case. Now, of course, there's outliers always on either end of the extreme, but the protagonist, the person that I wanted to look at in this story, was a young boy who's growing up in a world which is highly saturated already in kind of sex and porn and talk and bravado with his friends and peer pressure, and take this character at what is already a very confusing time in their lives, and then throw one of the most complex problems that our society has to deal with into the mix, into the kind of the middle of it. And it was never about trying to make the film kind of grotesque or shocking. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was never about shock value, and actually very little happens in the film. The majority of it is this bravado, is this talk, is this kind of, you know, pressure from his friends and so on. And until the very end of the film, nothing happens. But once you put this undercurrent in with the protagonist, the subtext in all the scenes becomes kind of palpable. And I personally always find that fascinating.
So thank you very much indeed for taking the time. I'm really looking forward to the screening on Sunday, and hopefully we'll get some rave comments from the audience, which I'll be sure to refer back to you.
Fantastic.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much.
Cool.
No worries, no problem at all, and thank you for screening it. I hope it can be of some help.